The world of Fallout is set in an alternate universe to that of our own. Where the culture of their world seems to have stopped in the 1950s, their technology has well surpassed that of our own. Nuclear energy powers their cities and cars. High energy laser weapons disintegrate their foes. Life prolongation measures ensure that the wealthy elite can stay powerful for a little while longer. Throughout the games, forums, and YouTube videos, we've heard of or have seen these incredible life-changing technologies. But there are some inventions that folks hardly talk about that are absolutely bonkers. Technology that would not only be life-changing, but era-defining. Let's go over them. Five of them, to be exact. This is five insanely OP pieces of Fallout technology that no one talks about. Matter synthesizers. We'll start off one that is absolutely unreal to me. The Garden of Eden Creation Kit, or GEC, was a standard issue piece of equipment meant to go to every Vault Tech vault. The kit would serve as a way for Vault Dwellers to establish settlements in the hostile post-nuclear environment. While the kit itself is quite the piece of tech, it's what's inside of it that makes an entry on this list. A terminal entry titled Introduction to the GEC in Vault 94 states that the device includes something called a Matter Energy Replicator. That's right, in order to terraform the world and develop a settlement, the GEC uses a sort of matter synthesizer to do so. It takes some form of power, in this case from a cold fusion power generator, and creates structural components, like the ones we see in Shady Sands or Vault City. That is wild to me. But it's not the only example of a device being able to create objects on demand with very little resource cost. In fact, the technology existed for food creation. Food synthesizers, or extruders as they were called, were developed prior to the Great War. These machines were able to take unwanted or surplus food and turn it into a nutritional, albeit undesirable, paste. The appeal of these machines was that the paste had an extremely long shelf life relative to other means of sustenance. Food synthesizers were standard issue among many vaults, and Enclave Research Facility Site J made use of the recycled food paste for around 6 years. But it would be the Commonwealth's Institute that would perfect the machine. Instead of providing the consumer with a uniform nutritional paste, options were given. Users could choose from a protein option, either beef, ham, chicken, or bacon flavors, a fiber option, lettuce, spinach, broccoli, or fruit flavors, and a fat option, peanut butter, ice cream, or grease flavors. All sound so delectable, don't they? And it wasn't only food and structural components that could be created using this extruder technology. In fact, again, many vault jumpsuits are created using jumpsuit extruders. It makes some sense, yeah? Instead of born vault dwellers having to sport hand-me-down jumpsuits, machines would create them. We know this because the Fallout Bible Zero mentions that Vault 70's jumpsuit extruder was designed to fail after 6 months. My wager would be that the extruder would use recycled clothes and dyes to manufacture the iconic blue and yellow jumpsuits for any vault dweller in need of a new one. And sure, while extruders, blenders, and drywall factories exist within our own universe, the Fallout versions of these technologies are quite a bit more state-of-the-art. The final example of a matter synthesizer within Fallout is something that would quite literally be unable to exist within our own world. This example might be the most overpowered piece of technology on this whole list. How about that, eh? Old Nort putting the best one first. It's not every day that a top 5 list is in reverse. Anyway, I'm talking about the Sierra Madre vending machines. These things are nuts. I say vending machines with air quotes because they're not quite vending machines. While you do insert some form of coinage and get some desired product, the product isn't stored within the device. The product is being made by the device. How bonkers is that? Elijah explains in the Dead Money DLC that the vending machines are actually assembly stations. He goes on saying that schematics are stored within dispensers with unlock codes. They use chips scattered around as batteries, alloys, and raw material embedded in the shell. They resemble the vending machines of the Mojave, but they are crafting devices of tremendous versatility. Once an old-world convenience, now they are a means of survival. Use the chips to power them. Select from the holographic display, the device will assemble it. The absolute ludocracy, I know it's not a word, of these things is why the crazed Elder Elijah sought the Sierra Madre in the first place, in addition to another piece of technology on this list. Elijah rightly believed that the vending machines could be used to craft a nearly unlimited supply of medicine, food, weapons, ammo. He would then use these goods, in addition to some other technologies, to end nations and rebuild them how he pleased. It's honestly quite a good thing for everyone that Elijah was stopped and the Sierra Madre was forgotten. If those vending machines got into the wrong hands, then, woo-wee, it would likely start a war. Combat holograms. Next on the list is another piece of technology that we find in the Dead Money DLC, the combat holograms. A hologram is a three-dimensional virtual image created by the interference of light beams. In Fallout, emitters and sensor modules create these 3D light images. While civilian applications of hologram technology are usually limited to holoprojectors, the military sought to, as usual, weaponize it. The idea for using weaponized holograms came about pre-war. According to a Dead Money loading screen, it is believed that hologram technology originally stemmed from Stealth Boy research in a scientific drive to match Chinese stealth suit technology. America wanted something that could rival China's cutting-edge stealth tech. And so the folks at the Big Empty research facility began working on how to weaponize these holograms. Despite having some initial success, another loading screen notes that hologram technology never achieved the same level of prominence, notably due to the excessive energy constraints. It would appear that the biggest roadblock for the weaponization of light in the form of a hologram was that they required a boatload of power to work. However, owner of the Sierra Madre, Frederick Sinclair, desperately wanted to use holograms for defense, and he was willing to pay good money for that. A requisition order terminal entry at the Z-38 Lightwave Dynamics Research Center reads, "If it wasn't for Sinclair's request, this hologram project would have been canned a long time ago." In addition to the dispenser tech he wants for the Sierra Madre, he spoke to the Big Empty execs about using the holograms for defense. That's something NE would have to sign off on. I can't even imagine the cost to turn the holograms into something beyond walking cameras and greeters. And why would you? It's only been a little while, and I already hate spending my time with these ghosts walking around the plant. Rather see the research money spent on actually improving the field of view sensors or adding upgrades to the emitters. While Big Empty researchers were hesitant with continuing their work on the holograms, Sinclair was adamant on having this hologram security force. So the hologram project continued. New breakthroughs, thanks to Sinclair's funding, solved a major problem that these holograms were having. Remember how I mentioned that the holograms drank energy for breakfast, lunch, and dinner? Well, a Villa Clinic terminal mentions that, as part of the Security Madre exclusive contract, the Big Empty have delivered on the custom energy recycling emitters requested by the Sierra Madre financiers and Mr. Sinclair. Now, what was a limiting factor when it came to the implementation of weaponized holograms was gone. The energy spent could be recycled, significantly reducing power consumption. Now, Sinclair would have his holographic security force operate indefinitely. And that truly was the big draw about having these weaponized holograms. Indefinite operation. So, say in the event of a global nuclear apocalypse, your property, riches, and most prized possessions could be protected from any unsavory people. You needn't worry about a crazed leader who is exiled from a techno-religious faction that is desperate to recreate the world as he sees fit. Your combat holograms have got you covered. Now, what makes these holograms insanely overpowered? Well, once again, Elijah has got us covered with that. He explains to the courier that the security holograms, ever since the bombs fell, now perform their function. They will kill anyone they detect. They are immune to guns, weapons, EMPs, even energy weapons. He does elaborate that while being immune to most arms, they do have two-ish weaknesses. Come on guys, they're overpowered, but not that overpowered. They do have weaknesses. Elijah mentions that their design limits their field of view, enough to avoid detection, and each has an emitter, destroy or disable it, and they cease to be a threat. So, one, their field of view is limited. This makes it so that some sneakier folks might be able to avoid detection. And two, their primary source of strength, or power, comes from their emitters. There are limitations. Now, these limitations can be mitigated. They're not done in dead money to make the DLC actually playable, but Sinclair very well could have implemented his holograms better as to downplay their two weaknesses. In order to prevent sneaky lads, the holograms would have to be placed in strategic corridors and chokes. Put them at the ends of long hallways and facing the direction of the anticipated intruders. Problem solved. And two, in order to prevent any meddling with the emitters, either reinforce the emitters so that they are less susceptible to attacks, or put them on an intersecting hallway to prevent any openings or line of sight. In open combat, I'd recommend getting a heavily reinforced armored personnel carrier, APC, and stash all the emitters in that, and then have the combat holograms patrol the outside of the APC. They move with the vehicle as an invulnerable death squad. Sure, while the enemy could attempt to disable or destroy the APC, they would be doing so while taking fire from unkillable red images of light. Sure, you might lose the APC and the holograms eventually, but not before taking much more of the opposing force with you. These combat holograms, aside from a few limiting factors that could be mitigated, are overpowered beyond belief. You can start to see why Elijah was so interested in the Sierra Madre and Big Empty. Those guys had some nutso tech. Onto something not from a New Vegas DLC. Visiontron loungers. You ever see or read Ready Player One? Everyone is just vibing in virtual reality so they don't have to live in the really crummy reality outside of the virtual space. The Fallout universe has something like that. In the Fallout 3 main story quest, Scientific Pursuits, the Lone Wanderer finds a holotape that indicates the location of their father. James set off to find Vault 112 after discovering that a genius named Stanislaus Braun resided there. When the Lone Wanderer discovers the vault under Smith Casey's garage, they come to realize that Vault 112 is no typical vault. Instead of what you'd normally expect, with dwellers roaming about and such, the residents have been suspended in a Visiontron simulation lounger. The Visiontron lounger is an oval-shaped pod. Situated inside is a single chair and some monitors. Behind the seat contains all the electronics and neural sensors for the occupant to participate in any given simulation. The pod or pods are then hooked up to a mainframe. In the case of Vault 112, a Think Machine 3600R mainframe. This is where the simulation actually runs from. These machines are crazy powerful. The residents of Vault 112 entered the vault assumably before nuclear hellfire rained down in October 2077. The events of Fallout 3 take place in 2277, 200 years after. This would mean that the simulation pods are capable of sustaining a human's life for over two centuries. And two centuries of augmented reality, though in a reality that isn't controlled by a mad scientist, might not be so bad. Surely it's better than being dead. But there's more to these pods than just their hardware. The interface between the simulation and neural connections allow for a hyper-realistic experience. We see this firsthand when doing the Tranquility Lane quest in Fallout 3. When the Lone Wanderer is hooked up to the rig, they experience an entirely new life as a young child in the seemingly peaceful simulated town. They're able to interact with the world as if it was real life, and others within the sim are able to react as well. Outside of using them as a really expensive gaming rig, they have other civilian and military applications. We even see some of these in-game. The near entirety of the Fallout 3 DLC, Operation Anchorage, takes place inside of a simulation pod. This specific simulation was designed to recreate the Battle of Anchorage. In this sense, the simulation serves as a way to strategically analyze the US Army's operation. This way, leadership can evaluate what went right, what went wrong, and plot further military operations with some more advanced information. The boomers of Nellis make use of some loungers in their second hangar. It is thanks to these simulation pods that the folks of Nellis learned how to fly. After all, where are you supposed to get a working plane? The bottom of a lake? Come on, man. The boomers would boot up some flying sims and practice using those. A lot less risky than attempting to fly a pre-war plane blind, you know? Another New Vegas faction, the Mojave's Brotherhood of Steel, have a select few Visiontron pods in their bunker. Using these along with some old pre-war VR tapes, the Steel is able to practice their general combat skills. It's hard to get target practice in when Elder McNamara won't let anyone out. According to head scribe Taggart, everyone in the base has to spend a minimum of 5 hours a week running the tactical simulations. These sims are seen as an effective way to train any military personnel on field operations and combat. In Fallout 4, within the frontier town of Good Neighbor, is the unique establishment known as the Memory Den. The Memory Den makes use of what seems to be several Visiontron loungers to allow those with enough caps to experience their own past memories. Or, I mean, if you have someone's cybernetic brain augmenter, you could theoretically delve into the memories of that someone. That works too. Outside of the applications we see in-game, these pods could also make for effective life prolongation pods. They could serve as an alternative to hospice care or provide an outlet for those unable to participate in society for one reason or another. They could be used to practice and train other high-risk professionals, high-rise construction workers, underwater welders, remote electricians, you name it. A Visiontron pod could help train people in those fields. The applications for these bad boys are endless. As a footnote, I feel like I should mention that while sure, VR, AR, and simulation technology exists within our own world and has its own professional applications, the hyperrealism of the simtech in the Fallout universe is the reason why the Visiontron pod makes this list. It's nuts. Die in the game, die in real life. What is this, Sword Art Online? On to the next piece of cracked technology. Repulsion fields. Locks, barricades, and other such tools are common ways to ward off trespassers and ensure the security of a facility. In Fallout, however, repulsion field technology exists and performs these same functions. It's quite powerful. A repulsion field is a type of security measure which prevents people, objects, or things from passing through them. Some form of repulsion technology has existed in every Fallout game. To start, there are the force fields. These barriers use some sort of projected light to halt access to areas or even stop projectiles entirely. Force fields of some kind have existed in nearly every installment of the franchise. Both the classic Fallouts have these yellow and red force fields. The yellow ones are impossible to pass, but the red ones can be passed through, usually at the cost of some HP. In Fallout 3, the Enclave makes use of some portable photonic resonance barriers to restrict access to the Jefferson Memorial after they commandeer the project. And in New Vegas, the Big Empty have their own sort of blue force field, only bypassed by the sonic emitter. In the two newer games, Fallout 4 and 76, while there are no force fields that block off access to certain locations, a similar principle is used as a sort of personal shielding for some characters. Coulter makes use of the Kohler Cars Arena to power a unique electrical shielding around his power armor, making him nearly invincible to conventional arms. And the imposter Sheep Squatch has a super duper overpowered shielding that makes the encrypted event completely unfun. Please change that. But these force fields are not the only type of repulsion fields to exist within Fallout. There are more. In Appalachia, many high-security locations like Sam Blackwell's Bunker, Vault 79, and the Pleasant Valley Ski Resort's luggage storage use laser grids. These are either deactivated through a handprint or remote detection of a person carrying the proper identification card on them. They are impossible to pass without the right credentials. I don't know why the laser grid is needed at the ski resort. There's never any good loot in those raider bags. In Operation Anchorage, the People's Liberation Army deployed a large EMP field around a refinery. According to Lieutenant Morgan, it generates a grid-based, localized electromagnetic pulse. Anything mechanical that goes through there gets all its circuits fried. It's this EMP field that prevents the US Army from attacking the Chinese compound head-on. If their T-51s attempted to cross the barrier, they would be destroyed. And the last two examples of repulsion tech being used in Fallout both come from, once again, the Old World Blues DLC, though these ones appear to be more niche. Upon entering the think tank for the first time, it's noted that a strange feeling of pacifism comes over you, and you find you cannot draw your weapon for some reason. What is later explained to you by the think tank members is that you're experiencing the effects of their pacification field. The field stops all feelings of aggression in those who lack a brain, lobotomites, and the courier. Quite strong. This makes it so that you cannot attack the think tank until your brain has been retrieved from the forbidden zone. And the second big empty repulsion device is the radar fence. Dr. Boris explains that the radar fence protects us all. It keeps anything with a disembodied brain inside, like the think tank, and anything without a brain also inside. So the radar fence acts as a type of barrier to anything without a human brain and body. This makes it so that the courier cannot leave the Big Empty before completing the DLC's main quest. 2OP man, I want off Dr. Mobius' wild ride. But that's a quick rundown for all types of repulsion field technology that exists within the Fallout universe. They're all quite strong in their own way, of course. Force fields seem to be the most universal, serving as a potentially portable, high-security door, or as a shield that can block weapon damage. The laser grids are a lot more restricted, really only preventing access to locations. The EMP field is the superior defense mechanism against robots and other powered devices. And the big empty fields are really just only effective against lobotomites. Still, repulsion technology makes for the perfect defense against anyone who's a little too nosy. After all, a locked door can still be lock-picked. On to the final overpowered technology. Cloning. Cloning is the process of creating duplicate copies of DNA, cells, or organisms. While cloning exists within our own universe, it's the primary way in which plants reproduce, the cloning of humans is one that has been met with controversy. In Canada, for example, the Assisted Human Reproduction Act makes it illegal to knowingly create a human clone. But in the universe of Fallout, gone are the cares and worries of ethical and moral dilemmas. Clone all you want. And that's what two companies, Vault-Tec and Nuka-Cola, did. Even though they maybe shouldn't have. At least two vaults, Vault 8 and Vault 108, were equipped with the means to perform some type of cloning. In Vault 8, Vault City, the physicians there used cloned human cells to make transplant organs. Dr. Troy, Vault City's primary doctor, explains that they can clone cells to make replacement limbs. This is useful for helping anyone with a defective or diseased body part. Troy uses the example of a spleen in his dialogue. In Vault 108, the cloning took on a different path. Vault 108 was a bit of a free-for-all when it came to its experiment. The Overseer was tasked with assigning all positions except for three. The Overseer also had a rare cancer that put his estimated death at 3 years into the Vault's 38-year lifespan, leading to some anticipated chaos. And the Vault-Tec scientists stationed at 108 were just cooking up whatever they could, the final course being a twisted cloning experiment gone wrong. A damaged holotape found in Vault 108 reveals a bit of information. Attempt number 53. Gary 53 is hostile toward all non-clones, as was the case with the previous 52 attempts. We may have to consider a means of disposal of the pre-existing Gary clones, as the observation rooms are getting quite full. Attempt number 54. Gary exhibits no change in hostility towards non-clones. If anything, he is even more hostile. Dr. Peterson can attest to this, having been injured while examining Gary 54. Tomorrow, we are going to dispose of several of the Gary clones, which will leave room for many more attempts. It would seem that a lone man, Gary, was cloned at least 54 times. Each Gary clone proved more violent than the last, attacking anyone that wasn't a Gary. By the time the Lone Wanderer visits the vault in 2277, only Gary clones remain. Interestingly enough, what this does imply is that Gary clones have a much greater lifespan than that of a typical human. If the vault lifespan was 38 years, I would assume that this cloning experiment would have taken place within that 38-year timeframe, meaning that the latest the Garys could have been made would have been at least 38 years after the end of the Great War. This means that the youngest living Gary found in the game, Gary 47, would be at least 162 years old. It's kind of wild. But I do have one question for the Vault-Tec scientists. What was even the point of this cloning experiment? If after 54 attempts the clones aren't getting any less violent, why keep it going? Surely a 55th Gary wouldn't lead to a sudden breakthrough. Anyway, the cloning done by Nuka-Cola Corp wasn't any more successful than Vault-Tec's. Built underneath the Welcome Center in the Safari Adventure portion of the Nuka World theme park was a cloning lab. At this lab, the scientists would frequently experiment on various animals. For example, they cloned some polar bears. Neato! These bears would explode shortly after due to some segmentation issues. Not neato. They also experimented on anteaters, attempting to give it 16 giraffe legs, scales, 4 eyes, and 2 tails. It should be noted that the doctor that came up with this concoction was drunk when doing so. But it was actually experiments done post-war that had the most success. Sort of. Dr. McDermott realized that their Nuka-Gen replicator could be used to repopulate the world with animals and stabilize its ecosystem. Noble task. While on a routine scavenging run, McDermott came upon a deceased supermutant. It was upon discovering the mutant that McDermott had an idea, an epiphany if you will. In order to protect the Nuka-Gen replicator from any ne'er-do-wells, he would genetically craft a guardian. And so, using DNA from a Jackson chameleon, an American alligator, and brain cells from the super mutant, he would craft the Gator Claw. The hope was that the brain cells would make the Gator Claws capable of understanding and following commands. McDermott would be wrong. In a final holotape recording, McDermott apologizes for creating the beast, noting that the Nuka-Gen replicator is out of control and producing more Gator Claws at an alarming rate. By 2287, Nukaworld's Safari Adventure is overrun with cloned Gator Claws. While the cloning of a human and creation of a mutant beast would have very few limited applications in my eyes, the creation of artificial limbs, organs, what have you, would work wonders for the field of medicine. When there is a problem in a patient, cloned cells could help fix that. With the right precautions in place, cloning could be used as a sort of miracle medicine. Of course, this would still come with the same ethical dilemmas that our own world faces when it comes to cloning. With that being said, cloning is still an overpowered piece of Fallout tech. And that is five insanely overpowered pieces of Fallout technology that no one talks about. A device that creates anything from almost nothing. Invincible walking light shows. A hyper-realistic virtual experience. A locked door on steroids. And 54 copies of A Man Named Gary. Thanks for listening. If you liked the video, be sure to share and subscribe. Have a good rest of your day. Cheers.
Ghosts. They filled the villa. More in the casino. Much more. They carry out the functions the dead once did. They cannot be harmed. They only perform the same rote tasks until their power dies.